Rachel, and I'm from the UDC, and I have a similar question to one that was just asked, which is a bit differently. So my question is that when the 2018 UN World Youth Report says that internships without pay exclude the poorest youth reinvestment and inequality, and when the UN Youth 2030 strategy says that establishing minimum quality standards across the UN for internship programs will ensure adequate compensation for interns and widen the internship pool. When Article 8 of the UN Charter says that there shall be no restrictions on the eligibility of men and women to participate in any capacity under the conditions of equality. When SDG 8 says equal pay for equal work of equal value. When SDG 10 says that we will reduce inequality. And when 50 years ago today, there were 130 P1 positions, but just now there are 17 P1 positions and there are 4,200 interns. And lastly, when paying interns is an administrative obstruction paid from an extra budgetary budget without membership approval, it is an HR document that has and easily be amended. Why aren't UN interns currently paid?
And the internship was conceived as an opportunity for young people to come and to have a short period in an organization to benefit from the context that it will provide and from the experience that it provides. And so the logic of looking into the internship as a category of staff was not in the intentions of those that created it. And in that context, it's perfectly reasonable that interns are not paid. Simply, we have three problems that in between happened in the organization. First, the number of internships has increased. Second, the duration of internships also has increased. And third, in these circumstances, there is a natural advantage of developed countries or of rich families of developing countries to allow for their children to be interns in the UN. And so, even if that is against the philosophy of internship, I think that we gave instructions to the Department of Human Resources to look into if there are ways, we have limitations, budgetary limitations, so this is not easy, but if there are ways to create some form of compensation to reduce the injustice that was created by the circumstances I referred. So we have a problem. The solution is not simple. We don't have the resources just to put interns at the same level as everybody else. We have not, because we came to a situation in which the weight is relatively big in the organization, but I recognize that we need to do something. Funding for the sustainable development goals in middle-income countries is an area where we have been quite active in addition to our different interlocutors, saying that when a country is middle-income, special vulnerabilities should be taken into account. The OECD finally is preparing a report on vulnerability linked to these in order to create some kind of a consensus that will allow international financial institutions and others to consider forms of concessional financing to middle income countries with special vulnerabilities. The problem is that there was no consensus on what vulnerability would mean. We had, when we were involved back in the Middle East, a very good cooperation that allowed to have Jordan and Lebanon benefiting from concessional loans of the World Bank because of the vulnerability created by the flow of refugees. Climate change is another example. Look at the islands of the Caribbean where I was just recently. So there is clearly a question. Then there are all forms of innovative financing, from the green bonds to social bonds, impact bonds, to the need of effective partnerships, to mechanisms of insurance that can allow for diminishing risks. And we will have one of the summits will be exactly on financing for development. So this is an area of great interest for us and where we need to give a lot of still must be done. And that is what internships again. Dear colleagues, unfortunately, we have to go to the next meeting. I wanted to thank you very much.